Well, Taylor, thank you again for joining us. And I thought we could begin at the beginning and just ask you about when and where you were born.
Oh, sure. Well, born, as they say, at a very early age, actually back east in Fredericksburg, and grew up around the Washington, D.C. area. Went to high school there, and when it came time to go to college, launched off to UT in Austin. I was convinced that nuclear fusion was the future, and it was going to happen. This was in, what would it be, like early 60s, right? And it was going to happen, they said, in about 20 years, which they say it's still going to happen in about 20 years. But UT at the time had imported a bunch of guys from Europe, and they were working on a tokamak, I think it's called, the torus, twisted torus. And so I was going to be a physics major, and I was going to solve the problem. And went to Texas and found out that I was not born to be a physicist. I couldn't picture myself in a white lab coat. I think part of it was probably when I joined a fraternity and discovered that there were other things besides science. But net-net is I wound up in math, because that was the simplest major to graduate with, given all the courses I'd taken as a freshman and a sophomore. And that's what actually, historically, led me into computers, sort of.
Did you have some experiences in high school that were that you think were important to your the development of your interest in physics, in fusion, in this area?
Physics and science. I'd always been almost self-taught since I was a little kid. About the only formation course that I took in high school, besides mathematics, that helped with computers was I actually took typing. Which is more about the fact that there were very few boys in typing and a lot of girls. But be that as it may. But I was a touch typist by the time I got to college, which was pretty rare in those days, actually. I actually made some money in college typing papers for people because most guys at that point hadn't touched a typewriter. So that meant key punching came a little bit more naturally to me, and unfortunately that was about the only computer that was available, certainly to undergrads at that point. UT had a pretty leading computer science department, but I was not in computer science. I was actually more in pure math, so that was really a chalk-filled environment as opposed to an electronic technology-filled environment. But the net that, though, was I took a couple of computer courses when I was, I guess I want to say, junior or senior year. First was a pretty simple Fortran course. The machine was the CDC 1604. And I think I told you the story. It had a tape compiler. So you fed punch, well, you actually didn't put punch cards in the machine. You handed them to a guy who then put them into the card feeder. And you could watch through the window, though, because they had a big glass window, and the compiler would pull routines off the tape, and it'd tick back and forth and so forth. But all the error messages were at the end of the tape. So you always knew when you were having bad luck, because the tape went zzzz like that and would pick up the error message, and you just kind of walk away from the window and wait for the bad news. I kind of hated it. One was it took at least 2 days to get that round-trip feedback. So you'd punch your cards up, put your deck together, find out you'd made a mistake, have to go back, make the fix, turn it around. With luck, you'd get your output, you know, by the end of the week, and it just didn't feel very tangible. Then I took a course in machine language, and I have no idea why I did that. I really didn't like that. It's even more tedious than the Fortran. And so I bugged out of school with kind of an image of computers as this kind of boring, bad turnaround, not very much feedback and so forth, and didn't really get back into computers at all until I started teaching math in high school.
Was it a common thing for your fellow students studying mathematics, math majors, to also be taking some computer courses?
No, not in the theory guys. The engineering guys typically did. But UT in those days, in math anyway, had pretty much, as long as you took 24 upper division hours, you could do anything else. Mm. So I actually minored in English and history. Hmm. And dabbled around with a bunch of other courses, including computer, just because I just wanted to see what was going on. And I had no idea at that point of what I was going to do. Now, when I did get out of school, that would have been 69, 70 time frame, there were starting to be some real jobs in computers. The economy was pretty bad, so I talked to RCA and a couple of other people, but didn't really see anything I liked, and I'm not sure they liked me either, given my attitude toward computers. And so I wound up teaching. Part of that was, to be perfectly frank, for a deferment, because that was 69-70 was the Vietnam era, of course.
Right.
And so I got a teaching job, and it was at South Oak Cliff High School in Dallas, where I was called a floating teacher, so I had very low seniority, so I didn't actually have a classroom. If it was second period, I was in this room, third period, mm-hmm. I was in that room. Well, one of the rooms that belonged to the senior math guy in the department had a teletype computer terminal in the back of the class. And it was tied into the old GE Mark II timesharing service. I think it ran on a GE 2235, one of the early, early timeshare machines. And I kind of looked at it, and felt it was basic, and there was a manual there, and I started to fool around with it. And as soon as I typed in a line of code, it immediately told me if I'd done it correctly or not. And then when I hit run, it actually responded. And it was like the heavens opened, you know, because remember, the experience I'd had was this agonizing thing. And it wasn't actually until UT brought in a 6600 that they had any terminals attached to any computers at all there. You may remember they wrote the Kronos operating system for CDC, which is the first kind of big multitasking OS that, and CDC shipped that to a lot of people, actually. Mm. But in any case, I was in love. And I started writing programs, and then I got the administration to let me teach an after-school class in it. Then I wrote a little attendance program. In those days, attendance was taken on punch cards and processed in the unit record equipment that you've got sitting out back there, 514 reproducing gang punch, an old 083 sorter, and so forth and so on. And so what I did is I built a little program with all my students' names in it, and I would call roll, and I had a kid sitting next to the terminal in my class, and if somebody was absent, they would punch in that student number, and then at the end of that process, it would print out an attendance roll, which I would then hand to the student that came by to pick it up to take to the office. And the office was like, what the heck is this? How is he doing this? You know, and so that plus the informal course I taught led to a summer workshop, first at University of Colorado Boulder. That was an NSF-sponsored workshop for teachers who were trying to introduce computers into the classroom. Now, this would be 71, 72 kind of time frame. And they had actually HP gear there that was associated with, let's say, Cherry Hills or something like that, school district there. And so we spent a summer there hacking around, writing programs, and starting to think about how we teach kids about this stuff. Then the next summer, after I taught another year at Oak Cliff, I actually worked with a professor at SMU, and we sponsored our own NSF summer workshop. Mm. And that led to one thing or another. But the point is that the administration kind of saw what I was up to, and at the time I was on an emergency teaching certificate, and they told me I was going to have to take practice teaching before I could. Now, I'd taught 3 years at that point, if I was going to stay in the classroom, I had to take practice teaching. I had to take a semester off. Now, I was married, had a kid, no way I could do that. Mm. But the administration, Dallas School District Administration, talked to me and said, hey, we have this position where it's a computer liaison to the schools. And you seem to know something about computers and stuff like that, and would you be interested? So I moved to that role. There was one fun thing about that. I gave my students a goodbye present. South Oak Cliff High School at that point was a state power in football. And of course, Texas football, particularly at the high school level, is everything, right? So I had worked with one of the coaches who was a part-time coach at the Dallas Cowboys on a computer scouting program for the high school team. A tendency analysis, pretty simple. The nice thing about high school football is you got a big tackle, you got a big fullback, pretty much, you know, there are very few, you know, interesting flavors of things you do, particularly in a third and short or something like that. So I had the coaches fill out a little form, which we punched onto cards, recording every play. So when they went and scouted another team, they would record all the plays that that team ran and what the down and yardage was and so forth. I wrote a big Fortran program that basically crunched all that and then produced a tendency analysis for an opposing team. So I remember it was fun. I'd sit in the stands and go, I think they're going to go off tackle on this one. And or they'd pass or something like that, or draw play. And the coach had a copy. And the kids, I'm not sure it did much good, but the kids were convinced it was mojo, right? it was the secret sauce of its day. And of course, in those days, the Cowboys had basically pioneered that in the early 70s, not just scouting other teams, but also scouting players and draftees and so forth. So there was that. So I had written that program. So my goodbye present to my students was an interactive football game. So what you did was you punched in the play you wanted to run, and then somebody else punched in the defense they wanted to call without knowing what the play was. And then a series of randomizations occurred that were basically based on that combination. Mm. And then it would record how far you got and what down it was, and you'd start the process over again. And basically, you could play pretty much all day back and forth, and it was actually fairly realistic. The kids loved it. And a number of those kids went on. I remember one of my students, you understand this is an all black school, and at the time, talented minority kids were being recruited by all the top colleges. Mm-hmm. So I had a student who went to Dartmouth from Oak Cliff, and I remember she sent me a postcard back of the Kiewit Computational Center, where BASIC was born, Kimony and Kurtz, of course, and said, hey, you know, just wanted you to see where I'm at now after that. So that was kind of cool, very rewarding stuff. But anyway, I got into administrative computing, a couple of years of that, and I got recruited by the local regional computer processing center. They had a giant in its day, IBM 370 158, but they also had a little HP mini computer time sharing system, the HP 2000. And that's what they wanted me to do. Let's take your educational computing, let's go back into the schools. They were trying to sell time on this machine to teach computer math. Well, I did that. I put applications on it like the guidance information system. So we put terminals in guidance offices to talk careers and choose colleges based on early parameters. Of course, this is all way before the internet. So you basically had databases, and that was about it. Mm-hmm. We did that, computer math. I started computer literacy. We started some programming classes for some elementary schools, fourth, fifth, sixth grade kids learning to program, of course, high schools. We wrote some applications. Finally renamed the whole thing the Instructional Computer Network, ICN. It was one of, in those days, there was TIES in Minneapolis, there was Region 4 in Houston, there was Philadelphia schools, and this Dallas organization.
Who ran it? Was it an independent? Who ran the whole operation?
In Texas, there were 20 educational regions, and some of them were considered super centers, where they basically sold computer services to the public schools. So up to that point, you had a lot of school districts, particularly larger ones, who had their own computer systems, but mm-hmm. it didn't really scale very well. There were darned expensive and obviously very difficult to program. So Texas established some regional centers, and Dallas was one, that basically school districts shared via, if you remember the term, RJE, remote job entry. So a school district would have a terminal into this monster IBM machine that did their grade reporting and their attendance accounting and all the rest of the stuff that finance, mm-hmm. Tax accounting, all that stuff that school districts had to do. We were fairly unique because we were also selling student timesharing services in addition to administrative services.
So it's a private company, not the
No, it was state. Actually an entity of the state, but it was not a government entity per se. It was kind of funded by the state and blessed by the state, but so quasi-governmental.
I get it. Yeah. I get it.
It still exists, and other states kind of have similar kinds of setups. So we built that up, started putting HP machines in various remote school regions, and eventually had hundreds of kids, or hundreds of terminals, I should say. So it was kind of an exciting time. A lot of those kids went on. I had a student, Fred, what was his last name? He went on to Southwest Technical Products and wrote their BASIC. He had written a Fortran compiler that emitted BASIC because the machines we had could only do BASIC. So if you wanted to do Fortran, you had to first translate it into BASIC. That was fascinating. He had a COBOL interpreter, a bunch of other stuff like that. Another kid who wound up at Apple in the original Lisa group, but the group that was trying to do with IBM the object-oriented OS, Pink. Mm. Yeah, so he came out of Dallas, out of that environment. So a lot of fun, a lot of sharp kids. Mm. And at the time when it was a real pioneering era.
It seems.
And in fact, I think you and I talked about this, at a time when you could actually understand how computers worked. It was like... Like today, for example, if you want to work on a car, well, you can maybe change the oil, maybe, right? But the notion of taking a cylinder head off and doing any work on a car, long gone. In those days, computers were like the four-cylinder visible V8, right? You could the eight-cylinder visible V8. You could actually see how they worked,
right?
And you could write OSs for them, and you could write compilers and assemblers and stuff. It was you got a sense of how it worked at the gut level. So it was fun.
And what, it seems like, things were going very well in that area, this educational computing area for you. Mm-hmm. What prompted a change for you?
Well, I actually got recruited. I had pretty high visibility within HP because I had bought a bunch of their stuff. And particularly, HP came out with a 2000 Access, and I'm not sure, but I may have bought most of them. But it was ultimately not a hugely successful product, but it was certainly perfect for what we were trying to do. And I got the attention of my local sales office there in Dallas, knew me pretty well. And I got a call because HP was looking, that was the old 3000, or GSD, they did the 2000 and 3000 series. And I got a call saying, hey, there's an opening in education marketing in the division. Would you be interested in talking to us? Mm. And at that time, the head of education marketing, I guess, had come to Dallas to see what we were up to and so forth and so on. So I flew off. That would have been 77, yeah. I flew off, and first time in California. And it was kind of fun. It was nice. They treated me well. I got to work with, briefly interview and even be in a lab a little bit with a couple of engineers who asked some questions, and I was able to answer them. The nice thing about that is that if you wanted to program well in that environment, you had to know the OS as well as the language. Because in the timesharing systems, pretty primitive in those days, time slice things. So if you knew how to grab more processor power than the next guy, your program would run faster. So there were tricks you could do to fool the OS into believing that your application was really a low priority when in fact you could make it a higher priority. Anyway, I had done some of those tricks and written some programs, so they were kind of curious about that. In fact, they were trying to figure out how to defeat that those tricks. And so we had a good conversation, and they offered me a job. And I I went for it, moved to California. I remember a long drive out, and in 77 was the height of the famous California drought. Mm. You know, if it's yellow, it's metal, that whole thing. And coming from Texas, which most people think of as dry and kind of deserty, was not at all. It was green compared to this brown wasteland that I had driven into, and I thought to myself, what have I done? But I had a good time. McCracken was running in the division in those days, Ed McCracken, who went on to found Silicon Graphics. And I worked for a woman who was also a UT graduate, Carolyn Morris, who was one of the founders of the Silicon Valley Women Engineers Society. Fascinating person, very bright. Had come up the line as an HPCE and worked her way into to a marketing role, business development stuff. They were, John Couch was there, who was Apple's VP software. Tom Whitney, who became Apple's senior VP of engineering, was in that division. The place was loaded with talent. And so I spent a couple of years there, first in education marketing, helping the company shut down the education market. They decided to hand it to DEC and focus on manufacturing. I was not a fan of that, but I did it anyway. I wound up being the one who got all the letters to Bill and Dave that said, what are you doing? In those days, HP owned the a group called the HP Business School User Group. So this was Chicago, University of Virginia, all the famous schools. They did the Huntington simulations. It was a very prestigious group. HP handed it away. So I did that, and then I moved on to datacom and sales development. I knew a lot about datacom. So I spent 2 years there doing what HP called the quantum theory of management. You ever heard that theory? But so the note, and this was, I'm not sure they called it there. A bunch of us wags called it that. But their idea, which was a wonderful management development thing, was so you'd have a job in a particular division or group in some function. And if you did well, you'd get recruited to a similar level job in another function. Hmm. And then another function. And then some quanta of energy, management blessing or whatever, would enter, and you'd pop to a next up management role, and you'd do the same cycle. Now, if you've done the loop a couple of times, you knew that things were not going well for your career. But basically, people popped up. What happened with that at HP, and it was instructive to me, I thought it was brilliant, was that by the time you got to be a senior manager at HP, you'd pretty much done every job in the company. Mm. So there were guys, you'd cycle through manufacturing, you were in marketing for a while, you were in support, you were in maybe in engineering, I mean, whatever roles. So I went around once, and I was actually ready to, the quanta beam was coming down. And then another beam struck, and that was a friend of mine who had worked there, who was actually had come. He'd done his rotation in GSD from the calculator division up in Corvallis. He had gone to Apple, and he called me up and said, "Hey, Apple's looking for an education marketing guy. Are you interested?" Well, at that point, I'd been out of education, but I still had that reputation. I knew how to talk to teachers. So I went over and took a look around, and was pretty excited. In fact, I remember going back to HP that day after the interview, and I still had my Apple guest sticker on. and the admin in our department said, "I think you probably want to take that off before you see Roy." And I said, "Oh, oops." I sure did. In those days, it was so bad. I mean, in terms of Apple's recruiting out of that division, because by then Whitney had left, Couch was either had left or was getting ready to leave. Whitney had put up a huge kind of hierarchical org chart on the wall of the engineering department with everybody's picture on it, right? And so many people left, they started putting Apple stickers over people's pictures when they were recruited away. So anyway, yeah, so I had my exit interview with, I think with Ed probably. And I think I said this, he named my offer to within a few shares, I think. They were so familiar. But he did. But I was very nervous about it because I remember talking to my mother, who was working for the government at the time, and she knew HP, and she was in back in D.C., and I was in California. And so, but at least HP was this legitimate company that she'd heard of. And I told her about Apple, and she was like, that sounds pretty risky. And I started to think about that. Maybe she's right. And then Ed said, by the way, if you do decide that it isn't working out, you've been doing well here, you can come back and you'll still have your seniority. And I went, that's good for me. All right, see you later. And I just headed out the door. Actually, they were going to walk me, but I was in the middle of a project, and so I couldn't tell anybody for 2 weeks while I finished the project, and then got out the door. Went over to Apple and started out right away.
This was the computer division of Hewlett-Packard that you were a part of?
Yeah, there were two. There was General Systems Division, which did the 3000 and the 2000, basically multitask timeshare machines.
Okay.
And in fact, the 3000 was sort of a conceptual copy of the old Burroughs 5500 stack machine. Mm-hmm. I don't know if, I didn't see a Burroughs out here, but 5500 was the first virtual timesharing machine pretty much ever built. That same stack architecture was what HP adopted for the 3000. But there was another division of HP called DSD, Data Systems Division. They did the real-time computers, the little minis.
Okay.
And remember, HP's, when they shipped a 3000 in this giant box, it still said measuring instrument on the side, right? And it took them quite a while to put the word computer in front of anything they did. But DSD really was, because of the real time. So they had the fast Fourier analyzers and that kind of software used a lot in process automation and so forth. But GSD was general purpose computing. So they actually had COBOL and nasty stuff like that. So. So the match, and it's interesting because within, was it DSD at that point? I forget. The HP terminals, their programmable terminal actually, was being developed at the time, the 2640 series. I didn't see one out there. But there was actually a mini BASIC for it. It was a great machine. Pretty expensive as a terminal, but a wonderful thing. And HP completely resisted turning it into any kind of interactive personal computer. The tiny BASIC somebody hacked, in engineering. But it was basically with that screen, everything looked like a Lisa. It just didn't have a floppy drive associated with it. But I thought that was the future. I had known that from the timesharing days. I mean, the reason I was so eager to leave the timesharing organization for education that I had done and go to HP in the first place was I thought timesharing was dead. Hmm. And the reason was the M-size, those machines, the first 8008-based machines, were going to kill timesharing. I mean, my customers were paying $3,000 a year for basically a teletype and access to this timesharing machine and the databases, right? But for $1,500 or less, maybe, you could buy your own machine, capitalize it once, and it was free from there on out. And I thought, man, there's just no way the economics are going to work. They weren't personal computers in these days, but microcomputers were going to kill timesharing. And so I was looking to get out of the business anyway. And then, of course, I was at HP for a couple of years, and they were basically doing nothing about what seemed to me a pretty obvious trend. Mm. And so Apple was like, okay. And clean sheet of paper, no legacy, just do it and kill the timesharing guys. And they were already in education, which is where, in fact, they were selling to the old HP timesharing base. So I could go in. I went to TIES, for example. I visited Region 10, my own Region 4 in Houston, all of these places that I knew from the HP timesharing business. When I was at Apple in education marketing, and basically was like, here's your answer. And we had ported all the most of the Huntington simulations to the Apple II, and so it was a done deal. The only thing Apple II didn't have was decent databases, so there was still a role for machines like that, but not for computer instruction, not anymore. So anyway, it was
two
fun.
Quick questions,
sure.
If I could. That kind of the general computer division that you were a part of, where was that located physically? Like, where was your office?
So the first, let's see, that was in Santa Clara, so it would have been, where was the building? It wasn't on the Wolf Road campus. That was where DSD was. So I believe it was the Santa Clara campus, which at that point was shared by the optical division. You know, they made the little sensors and stuff like that. In fact, there's a picture of that building when GSD was formed. There's a famous picture of McCracken's office, which was a cube in the dead center of this huge, I mean, we're talking, you know, maybe 50,000 square feet or something like that, crazy. And he, like, had a single cube in the middle, and there were no cubes around it. And so they basically built it out. Remember, in those days, the only people at HP that had offices with doors were Bill and Dave.
Okay.
So everybody was in this. And in fact, it was interesting because it was so egalitarian in that sense that all the corridors to get to the cubes were on the outside of the building near the windows. Nobody got a window office either.
Huh.
So. We broke a few of those rules at Apple, but in fact, that was, speaking of cubes, that was my first experience at Apple. When I got hired, it was in the old Bandley 1 building, 10260, and I went in, and they had just moved manufacturing out to Bub Road. And so the space that used to be manufacturing was where they were going to put these new marketing people they just hired. And but there were no cubes, there were no desks, no nothing. I said, so where do I sit? And they said, well, and they pointed to the wall, and it was a stack of those old Westinghouse panels and an Allen wrench. And so I built my office. In fact, I remember a few months later, somebody came in and was complaining, how come Taylor's office is so big and mine's small? Pretty simple.
Got here first.
I got here first and took the big panels. Yeah, that was pretty wild.
So was your office at Hewlett-Packard, was it closer to kind of where Apple was located than to sort of the main headquarters of HP, or was it?
Well, yeah, main headquarters of HP, and the labs were all up in Palo Alto.
Right.
So, yeah, that Apple was, what, a couple of miles away, just right up on at Wolf Road, that was where 280 and Stevens Creek came in, was where that plant was. And yeah, so it's maybe a couple of miles up the road. Yeah.
To go back to that time in Texas when you saw the rise of, we'll call them the microcomputers,
sure.
And you know, you had this realization that time was short for time sharing, I guess. How were you becoming aware of those developments? How were you following kind of what was happening with microcomputers, both in Texas and then when you came to the Bay Area working for Hewlett-Packard?
Well, one of my vendors that I was getting, deck writers from and renting the teletypes was starting to experiment with, was starting to actually look at selling some of those machines. So this would have been 76, 77. I was also aware, I want to say at that point, Southwest Technical Products in San Antonio was starting to build some machines from scratch. There was obviously MSI. So I was reading some of the magazines and that kind of thing. At that point also in San Antonio was Computer Terminal Corporation. Oh. So some of the early CRTs, right? So I had a couple of those. And so I was kind of familiar with the scene down there. Most people have forgotten, there's quite a bit, ArcNet came out of there. I mean, there was quite a bit of stuff going on in San Antonio in those
right.
days. and just my proximity to Dallas. But I was also, well, I was looking at microprocessors, I was looking at a lot of things, yeah. So, yeah, it just seemed obvious at the time.
Could you paint a little bit, or fill in the picture of that offer to come do the educational marketing job at Apple? Who approached you? What was it like? What did it feel like when you got there? Who were the people that you spoke with? You know, just flesh that out.
Sure. Let me think. So it was probably, let's see, Carolyn Morris, you said, was the lead. She was running the sales development organization at that point. And as I said, we shared the experience at UT. She was in math also, but I think applied math. And she was a striking person anyway. About maybe 6'1", 6'2", beautiful woman. But with a bad habit of slumping, because every guy she worked with was shorter, and she had a tendency to wear heels, and then which made it worse. In fact, she and McCracken dated for a while, and it was because Ed was maybe my height or maybe even a little shorter, and so it was kind of like. And I remember telling Caroline, I said, you know, hey, if you're going to wear heels, just stand up, you know, come on. But she's a great lady, and she had a vision for the thing. I didn't really, there was another guy who was running the education part of that marketing group, Gary Stump. He wound up, I think, at up in Oregon at another tech company, I want to say Tektronix or mm-hmm. something like that. Stumpy was a fantastic guy and just a gregarious personality. And he had taken over education basically to engineering had cranked out a couple of products designed for the administration part of the education market. Mm-hmm. And so part of the job at that point was to launch those. So I remember talking to a couple of the engineering section managers that were responsible for those products. And the good news was, I mean, it was a scheduling package, it was, and a couple of other administrative packages. And I had done education administration and scheduling, so I was very familiar with the issues. And so they, in fact, I think the person who, I talked to the person who wrote the program, and it was scheduling school classes is a hard problem. It's at the time, a lot of applications were just brute forced it. So you'd fill up a class and oops, that didn't work, and you'd drain it a little bit and try again and stuff like that. It was nasty, took hours and hours of computer time, expensive computer time. This guy had written a, like most HP guys, there was a lot of intellectual power there. So they'd hired somebody who understood routing theory and all this kind of stuff. So he had written this elegant thing in systems programming language, or ALGOL, I guess, at the time. And so he wanted to, he waxed poetic about it, and I actually knew enough about it to appreciate what he was doing. And we had this kind of little love fest and stuff like that. But I was charmed by the, I thought the people were really bright. And I thought, and I was ready to, get within a structured company. I'd been kind of running my own thing, and but I was nearly 30 years old at that point, and I thought working for a company with some sort of structure and stuff would be important. And California was a good break for me too. Mm. So, but yeah, it was an impressive group. And the other thing I remember about it is how organized they were. So they had a folder full of stuff that said where I was staying and where my car was, and they had this, and they had a structured schedule. And I had never seen things so organized before. I was used to pretty sloppy kind of thing. So I was thinking, oh, this is pretty cool.
What did it look like at Apple when you went into, was it, I would imagine there was a contrast.
Yeah, well, to give you a feeling, Eddie, somebody or other, who was the HR guy at the time, I met him about a week after I joined the company. I remember this guy roaring up on a motorcycle, took his helmet off, and said, "Are you Taylor?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Oh, I think it was Eddie. I'm the HR guy. I think there's some paperwork I need to get you to fill out." Yes, there was. So, yeah, that, building my own desk. The thing at that point, though, was I was pretty comfortable with that. Again, I'd been running my own thing in the timesharing network, and I was used to kind of making my own way. I wound up working for a guy, Greg, I can't remember his last name now, who was the director of education. Remember, in those days, also Apple had the Education Foundation. So they had actually a nonprofit they had set up in parallel to Apple's marketing effort that promoted computers in education. Oh. And so he managed both the Apple marketing piece and the foundation. Greg was a traditional guy out of CDC, and he was probably the most straight-laced and organization man guy in the whole company at that point. He was also about 10 or 15 years older than anybody else, and was not very technically oriented. He knew marketing, he knew the process and stuff, and he had some background in education, which is why they hired him. But the rest of us are kind of wild people in his view. And I always liked, the thing I also noticed about Apple, like with HP, was that tradition of wandering around in engineering. Hmm. So HP had the management by wandering around theory from the top down. I was a big believer in that. And that same culture existed at Apple in terms of go talk to anybody and find out whatever you need to do and just get it done. Hmm. And so I formed some, and remember, I'd been a programmer. I'd written a lot of code. I understood operating systems. I certainly understood the technology of the two, and so Apple II. And so I was pretty comfortable around engineering. And my first assignment was, of course, the Bell and Howell Apple, getting the black Apple, getting that out the door, and that was just a matter of getting UL approval for the Apple. Because Bell and Howell required that before they'd ship it to schools. At that point, Apple II was not UL approved. And in fact, we had to pay, $25 a unit to LA, to the fire department in LA, to be able to sell computers in Los Angeles because they weren't approved. Mm. And nobody paid much attention to it. What the heck? It was that kind of informal kind of company. But and there were only a couple of hundred people in the whole company at that point anyway.
That's right.
So I had to get UL approval, and the only obstacle to that was a guy that maybe you've interviewed, hopefully you have, Rod Holt.
I haven't, but the name is
so Rod
familiar.
Was out of Atari. He was an absolute genius and invented the switching power supply.
Mm-hmm.
Rob did not suffer fools, I guess is the way to put it. And in his view, the UL power engineers, who were the ones who looked at power supplies for UL approval, were Philistines who couldn't possibly understand this brilliant thing he'd done. And he was probably right about that. But the thing about government functionaries is that they don't care. It's like, okay, we don't get it, and you're not going to explain it to us, and you think we're stupid, and so we're just going to sit on this thing. Well, that was the impasse at that point. So nothing was happening when I took it over. And Bell and Howell was calling every day, when are you going to get approval? We're ready to ship, and so forth and so on. And it's like, wasn't happening. So I found a young engineer who was not quite so prideful, who was actually willing to document the thing sufficiently for UL to understand what was going on. On inside and understand also it wasn't going to blow up. Because remember, at that point, we were talking high frequencies and high voltages, and it was not the sort of thing where you just took 110 and made it into 12 and, mm-hmm. through a transformer and a bunch of rectifiers. And so so we got it approved. It took about 6 months. And Bell and Howell was happy, and we shipped the things and so forth. But it was interesting.
That agreement was already in the works then, if they were clamoring for it.
They had shaken hands. Somebody had figured out how to spray paint the Norel, case black. And they'd even come up with a logo. I can't remember. But in any case, it was a done deal. But remember, in those days, there was no documentation. There was no process involved. They knew how to manufacture it because they had people who'd done that and knew what to do. If they needed more screws, they'd call up somebody and order some more screws. There were no processes in place. And so to actually create a product, a new version of the product, and get it to a company like Bell & Howell, who actually demanded documentation, drawings, for example. Well, you know, where are the engineering drawings? Well, we have a sketch. Would that be okay? So there was a whole, it was the first time that Apple had to explain what it did to somebody else, somebody who had rigid conventions and processes, who'd done a lot of outsourcing. Now, the flip side of that, Bell & Howell was a company that was dead from the inside. I'll never forget touring their Chicago factory, such that it is a big empty space, and their labs. Their labs were like HP museums of vacuum tube voltmeters. I mean, the Apple labs, absolutely latest hardware, engineers got whatever they needed, you know, that they needed to build. The Bell & Howell labs were, they were obviously not doing any development. So it was kind of sad in one sense. On the other hand, they knew how to do stuff, process stuff. So that was a discipline that that Apple needed at the time, and it really helped.
And they also had existing contracts into the education world.
Remember, that was they were selling projectors. Well, the thing they had was a sales force that called on education, right? So the projectors and the overhead things and all the rest of the stuff. Apple was looking for a distribution channel. Remember, at that point, you had a few hobby dealers, a guy named Ron Rohner, who's my partner today in the consulting business, was the one who built Apple's first channel. He came out of consumer electronics. And he worked for Fred, I'll remember that, the VP of sales, but the Gene Carter. He worked for Gene Carter, and but Apple had no salespeople in the field. And the dealers they had were mostly hobby dealers. And so there was nobody calling on education, per se. So the notion was get a distribution channel, get somebody who's calling every day, put something in their bag that's this new technology, and so forth. By the time the deal was really done, though, and by the time we got it out the door, and by the time they got some traction, Apple was also building its own reputation in the education market. And so it didn't take too long before the deal kind of became irrelevant. But it was, again, good discipline.
How big of a target was the education market for Apple at this time and maybe its competitors, to the extent that it had them, versus the office or
The science. Office really didn't exist as a market at that point. It wasn't really until VisiCalc in late 79, early 80 that became a feasible target. So education was important because what the Apple II could do, which was deliver basic programming experiences with color graphics, was exactly what education was looking for from the standpoint of computer literacy.
Okay.
And the big push at that point was computer literacy. And it didn't require disk drives. It didn't require a whole bunch of stuff that business applications did. And the competitors at that point were reasonably successful in education. You had the Commodore PET. You had the TRS-80. The thing about those machines was the PET was significantly limited in a number of ways from a programming standpoint. Memory and so forth. And remember when Apple introduced Pascal, the language card, and UCSD Pascal, it took a step also into higher education where those other products were not competitive. Radio Shack, the 80, and remember late 79 or early 80? Yeah, when the FCC stepped in and required personal computers to meet emission standards. And that was the death of the Trash 80, or the TRS-80, pardon me, I speak ill of the dead. But the TRS-80 could not be made to pass FCC because it had too many pieces and wires and boxes and stuff. And the PET had serious problems too. Mm. With the Apple II, I was the Apple II product marketing manager by that point. We figured out how to coat the inside of the Apple II with some metallic paint, ground it in a number of ways and stuff, and we actually got the almost exact unit to pass FCC. In fact, funny story about that also about Rod Holt. Rod was, as I said, a genius, and part of it was because he thought in different ways than most people. So at that point, to test for FCC approval, most people were creating at enormous expense these radio wave dead rooms, mm-hmm. right, shielded and so forth and so on, so they could test the emissions of the box without interference. Well, Rod said, the problem with building one of those rooms here in the valley is there's too many radio waves already, microwaves, everything else. So Rod bought an RV and went out to north of Santa Cruz along the coast, where everybody knows you can't pick up a radio signal for life, right? I mean, you drive along and your AM radio is just useless. There are no signals because you're completely blocked by the mountain range. So he just set the stuff up in the middle of a field. You know, so the entire, you know, somebody else is spending $1 million, he was spending whatever it was for the RV plus plus these sensors. And he just set the Apple II up on a thing in the middle of the field, put his sensors around in a circle, and he was done. So we, and then of course we took the result, and we knew it would pass, and handed it to the FCC, who put it in one of the rooms and actually verified that it worked. But I don't know many people know that story, but it was but that was the way his mind thought. It's like, yeah. Well, why would I solve the problem that way when I can solve it this way? Yeah. So anyway, but that was some of the story of there.
So it sounds like you were just in that educational marketing role for a brief time then, yeah. Less than a year?
Or? Maybe a year or so, okay. Yeah. What I did was I came in, I did the Bell and Hall Apple, the FCC thing, not FCC thing at that point, the UL thing. I also got Pascal out the door. I was the product marketing manager for that, and I'm proud to say the marketing manager for the Apple Pascal poster. And as I think I told you earlier, I still have one that has Nicholas Wirth's signature on it that John Couch got for me in Switzerland when he saw them. But so I got Pascal out the door, and that was a big breakthrough for higher ed. That was, Ken down at UCSD, he had done the P machine and all that, mm-hmm. and that was a very expensive kind of choice. We built a language card, extra 16K, stuck it in the Apple II, and bingo, you were off and running. And as part of that, we did 16 sector DOS, which was another whole story. But in any case, having done that and getting a little faith in the hardware, Steve Jobs was running product marketing at the time, and Phil Roybal was the Apple II guy, and Phil was moving more into a more general marketing and customer service kind of role, and so I got tapped for the Apple II job. And part of that was, even then, I mean, Apple II was obsolete by 1980, right? I mean, from a technical standpoint, 6502 was, although it was one of the first RISC processors, it was hardly leading edge at that point. So the Apple II was really all about making it work in volume. Mm. And I think I demonstrated that I could get stuff out, I could get stuff documented, I could work with engineering on that. We had the 16-sector DOS to do, which was important to software development at the time. Because remember, programs were starting to show up that actually did business stuff. So you had Markle with the stock package. You had little Apple plot package. You mm-hmm. had a couple of, Don Williams did not multi-plan at that point, but the precursor to that desktop plan. And then the controller. So when Apple shipped the disk drive, the first floppy disk at this insanely low price because of Woz's, you know, magic state machine. When Apple did that, it built an era for software development on that platform, and stuff started to appear. And then, of course, VisiCalc as well. Well, to do that, you needed a decent, reliable, you know, disk system. You needed enough storage. So the Apple II is really all about taking the technology as it stood and just making it work reliably constantly. We had early problems, too. The disk drive had media changed, and so suddenly disks started to fail. So a lot of it was just basic quality management and blocking and tackling. And the other thing that was going on is the channel was evolving. So you had resellers and dealers who were actually starting to look at things like accounting on it as a platform. And it was starting to steal share from the bigger machine, the more classic business machines. It was cheaper, more reliable, more profitable for them, and so forth. So it was really about execution, and that was fun for me. The other thing it was about was, I think, the characteristic of the Apple II was always kind of a lack of hubris, right? If you think about the characteristics people think of Apple, and particularly which started with the Mac, and actually before that, even with the Lisa, it was like, we know what you want to do with a computer, pay attention, and we'll explain it to you. With the Apple II, it was like, and to a certain extent the Apple III, although the early issues with Apple III marketing also had to do with hubris. We'll talk about that in a minute. Mm-hmm. But particularly with the Apple II, it was like, here's this cool thing, here's how it works. Why don't you see what you can do? So for me, the most exciting, for example, the classic was the Atom contest, right? You may have heard about that before. But what in the world would you do with an Apple II? So the idea was a contest where users tell us their most innovative application, and we have a prize for the coolest app. The guy who won it had taken an Apple II with an analog board, A to D board in, which you hook to a mic, and some analog board out, motor control boards, hooked to some servos. He put the mic in the bedroom where his colicky baby was, and written a program that basically said, you know, figured out some crying patterns or noise patterns in the night, and if it met a certain criteria, the servos would go and rock the cradle.
Oh my gosh.
Well, as a marketing guy, you don't want to say, well, you know, talk to a bunch of engineers and say, hey, I think we could build this thing that quiets babies, right? So nobody was going to think about that. But we gave people the tools, the analog boards, the motor control boards, the mic input, the programming language, the and so forth and so on. We gave people all the tools so that their creativity could be featured. And so it was that lack of hubris. I had a line in the Apple IV business plan about building a new technology platform like that so that, quote unquote, users can continue to surprise us with what computers are good for. Hmm. And the transition, in fact, I used to call before it shipped, when it was first conceived, when Steve first took the idea from Jeff for the Mac, I called it TCTDFT, the computer that does five things. And for me, it was a joke because why in the world would you want a computer that just did five things? By not putting a language in it, by not giving it enough memory and so forth, you basically made people use it a certain way when people actually wanted to do a whole bunch of cool stuff with it. And so that kind of tension within Apple, the hubris of we know what to do, and the faction that said, remember when when Woz put the Apple II together, for that matter, the Apple I, before that, but the Apple II, it was the Red Book. All the peaks and pokes, right? Here's, you know, here's a interpreter. Here's all the stuff. Go for it. And they did.
I was just, you know, thinking about those two camps of kind of the hubris and the one right way, and then the kind of, you know, platform, open platform, and you have two Steves to choose from, and you could easily see. Were those the two camps? I mean, did they kind of gel around that?
I felt like it. It was one of the reasons why I left in late 82. And one of the reasons why I did software instead of hardware. I had a couple of offers to go create the next big clone or whatever. And I had spent my career at Apple, such as it was, 3 years or so there, trying to make sure that nobody, except maybe IBM, could get into the computer business, the personal computer business. So software looked like the only thing. But the thing was that, there wasn't really a place to go to build another Apple II. What the Apple IV was, of course, was a follow-on to the III, was a 68,000-based open color graphics. It was basically a sun. I realized it a couple of years later when I looked back at the old Apple IV business plan is that we were really trying to build a sun box because it had a Unix in it. We had a couple of sources for non-AT&T Unix. In those days, there were a couple of basically work-alike Unix versions, so I thought Apple could probably ship a Unix that wasn't going to interfere with AT&T's rights and put it in an Apple II-style open machine at 68,000, and we were going to aim it at scientists, engineers, statisticians. Remember, Apple had built, I think I mentioned this to you, the SANE environment, standard Apple numeric environment, the KCS mathematics. So I knew that engineers, analysts, stock and bond guys needed a platform to do their creativity with, and software developers needed that kind of platform. So we had this notion, but it didn't work out.
Well, to take a maybe step back a little bit.
Am I wandering around?
Well, no, not at all. Maybe my mind is wandering. But no, just to go back to something, it seems that when you got that job with the Apple II, that's quite an important job for the company. Because my recollection from what I've read, that's where the money that the company had was coming from, correct?
Exactly. Yes, but it was also the place that it was the mundane place. The thing was that you got to remember that the priority at that point was all about the Lisa and the Mac. First the Lisa and as it crumbled, the Mac. And so the Apple II was simply a place in the Apple III, for that matter, because we got the revenues up pretty strongly by the end. That was my last job before I left. But the notion was that was just the bank that people drew on. So if you looked at, in fact, I remember a funny story, two stories. Apple employees always dressed up at Halloween. That was a famous tradition, and people wore costumes and so on, and pranced around campus and so forth. At that point, we were all over in, so this would have been 80, probably Halloween 81, 82. I think we were in Banley 3 at that point, almost 180 people packed into that one building, 5x7 cubes. It was pretty grim. Across the street was the Lisa building, I want to say Banley 4. And so we were all dressed in costume, frolicking around and so forth and so on. And the Lisa building at that point, you had to have a special badge and a sticker on your badge to get in. So none of us had ever been in the building. At that point, I was product marketing manager for the two and the three. And so I led this band. I think I was one of the Andrews sisters that year, and so I led this band across the street, and we simply danced right past the guards, and into Bandley 4, the Sanctum Sanctorum of the Lisa Group. That was in the Trip Hawkins days, right, who went on to Electronic Arts. But so all the folks that worked for him were similarly, it looked like a basketball team. They were all kind of tall and lean and scholarly looking and wore coat and tie and stuff like this. So we dance into this building. And what we find is indirect lighting, a fountain, 10 by 10 cubicles, kind of quiet, restrained atmosphere and so forth. And we looked around, and again, we were coming from this nightmare of 5x7 cubes. We looked around and we said, oh, there's two apples, and we're in the other one. So literally, quietly filed back to our offices. It was, I was shocked, because it was, when I walked into Apple, again, having built my own cube and wandering around engineers and dropping into Markla's office to talk about stuff and hearing, you know, Whitney and Scotty argue in the hallways, it had become a completely different company in 3 years. I was shocked.
Huh.
And so were the people that were with me. And that was the other thing that probably left me, it led me to exit at that point, because the company was being run by people who, in my opinion, didn't know enough about computer technology to know the right thing to do. That was, I think I told you, in 81, I met with Bob Metcalf and Bill, his CEO, about putting an Ethernet card in the Apple III, which we really need. We had two kinds of networking at that point, OmniNet and the ARCNet stuff, and badly needed Ethernet. And of course, the Apple III was the perfect operating system for Ethernet. We had device drivers with multiple entry points. We could do networking. We could do a network printer. I mean, it was all built into the OS. All they had to do was write a driver. And Metcalf was impressed. But then they went over and saw the networking experts in the Lisa group and got talked into the serial interface box, the $1,000 Ethernet interface that took 10 megabit Ethernet in one side and spit out 1 megabit serial on the other, which just was nonsense. And so it was just, yeah, my opinion was, you know, people running the company didn't know enough about technology to understand the right decisions. And so that, and that was the, you know, it's interesting. Sales is always the lagging indicator, right? So what you sell today is what you invented a year or so before.
Right.
And if you're not inventing anything today, you don't quit selling today. Sales happens 2 years in the future. So what was happening in 83 led to disaster in 85. Pure and simple. About a 2 year lag.
Hmm.
The success in 83 was all about what had been done in 81.
Well, let's talk for a little bit about the Apple III project.
Sure.
and how you came to it, your role in it, and it seems to me that if this is happening, was the Apple III project happening simultaneously with the Lisa project?
No,
it was preceded it.
Come well before.
Okay.
Actually, when I came in 79, it was pretty well set.
The three.
Steve, most people don't realize this because of the revisionist sense of history that surrounds Apple, but Steve was deeply involved in the Apple III project, down to figuring out how many bits the A to D converter was going to have. In fact, I remember wandering in his office one time when engineers were playing various tapes of voices at 4 bits, 6 bits, 8 bits, and so forth. And the case had been designed, the logic Wendell had figured out all the stuff, and the OS was just about built. Tom Root had just finished about that, and device drivers were being written and so forth, 79, 80 time. Remember, the product launched in the spring of 80 at NCC.
Okay.
And And I looked at it as the Apple II guy at the time. I mean, it was my quote-unquote competition, right? So a good marketing guy wants to know, I mean, there was nothing else in the marketplace that was particularly competitive. It was a significant engineering leap at that point. And so I paid a lot of attention to it. Unfortunately, the marketing team at the time, who were some ex-chip guys, didn't understand systems, didn't understand technology, didn't want to talk to engineers because they kept promising stuff that the engineers couldn't deliver, and so engineers were mad at them, so they didn't want to go back and talk to those guys because they get yelled at. So I could see kind of the disaster looming, but because I did talk to engineers all the time, so they would, like, but understand that the anticipation and the rumors were high. I remember going to a Apple user group meeting, so the heads of like Apple Pie and all those guys were in a special screening of the Apple III prior to launch at NCC, and they were all over it. They wanted to know how it worked. They wanted to know this, what about this OS, what's this all about, and so forth. And there was no technical documentation. The marketing group had decided that what they were going to do is a word processor, word painter, they called it, and something else, a numbers package or something like that. I remember one of my guys dubbed it the Painter Sisters, but I can't remember what the other sister was. So they were going to put some business applications on it. They had VisiCalc. They had a port of VisiCalc that Bricklin and those guys had done. And in fact, it was going to be a super VisiCalc because you could have large VisiCalc models, bigger than anything else that you could put on a PC, larger than 64K. So they were going to make it a business machine. Therefore, from a hobbyist standpoint, they felt that picturing it as a technology-based machine would be harmful to the business positioning. It's called business basic because they didn't want people to think they could do anything else with it. So as a result, there was no OS documentation. There were no device driver manuals. There was certainly nothing equivalent to the Red Book. And in fact, that part of Apple marketing sort of aggressively tried to suppress knowledge about how it worked. They said Apple II cards wouldn't work when they would. They said a whole bunch of other stuff. And so net is that it launched as much less interesting machine than it actually was. The OS was completely innovative. I mean, it was basically a single user Unix, you could look at it that way. It had a hierarchical file system. It had not only device drivers, but it also had event fences, both software fence and a hardware event interrupt system. It had named memory segmentation. It was head and shoulders above anything else. And it was called Sauce, as you know, because of Sarah, Wendell's daughter. But the marketing guy's genius said, oh, what starts with S? Sophisticated. It's like, oh, good grief. I remember just being painted. Structured, maybe, but not sophisticated. But anyway, so basically they fizzled the launch because they failed to think about how much energy there was in the Apple II base to have a better, more interesting, more powerful machine.
And they felt that would be contradictory to this business market where it was supposed to be just sort of a plug and play.
Yeah. At that point, they were already drinking the Lisa Kool-Aid about, you know, closed business machine. And so the problem was that it's hard. It was still a 6502, and it was still, I mean, it had a sophisticated memory management capability, you know, and so forth, but they called it bank switching instead of its correct addressing, so people dismissed the memory management of it. It was a failed launch by people who didn't understand the technology. And then, of course, on top of that, the darn thing didn't work from a hardware standpoint. Because they tried to pack too much stuff into it. And, of course, Steve declared that it couldn't have a fan, and therefore it ran too hot, and et cetera, et cetera. So by the time I took it in late 81, 82 to do the turnaround, what we call let me reintroduce myself, and got the sales back up, it was more, it had gotten a stunted launch, and the IBM PC got in. It was much less interesting technically, the IBM PC, than the Apple III. But by then, the company wasn't telling that story, and they'd missed a year worth of lead in the marketplace.
So, did you clamber to get to do that relaunch, or did somebody come and grab you and say, please do this?
So I don't know if it was Black Wednesday, Black Friday, whatever that thing was, where a bunch of people got the axe at Apple in 80. At that point, I inherited the customer service operation for the three, and we put the turnaround program together. Got about a $3 million budget, and I had gotten the two was in pretty good shape. We'd started the 2E project, and I'd given that to Mike Connor. And so I moved over to the three to do the turnaround. And it was, I can't remember if I was asked to do it or if I was just the last person standing. It was not a popular thing. One of the marketing guys had left, the head of Apple III marketing, Don Bryson, had left, and the other guy, Barry Arconi, had moved over to the disk division at that point to do profile. And so there was nobody left. So I started that process. We got some training out. We got documentation folks started on the device driver manual and the sauce manual and so forth. And I hired a guy. I heard a guy named Jerry Bauer who did the actual customer service part of the turnaround. He was, I remember his resume fondly. He was from Cornell. He'd been in the computer business for a while, but his degree was a PhD in taxonomic entomology. Basically, how many hairs are on the back of a fly determines what species it is, or what genus is, or whatever. And I thought, now there's a detail guy. And he was. He was an animal for detail. We got a stack of Apple IIIs that worked, and people wrote in and they said, my Apple III doesn't work, so we'd ship them a new one. And say, please send the old one back. And if that one didn't work, we'd ship another one. We had some people that got four or five of them.
Wow.
And by the end of that process, people started to realize, holy moly, these guys are willing to spend anything it takes to make me happy. And some of our biggest detractors became our biggest allies. And remember, I mean, the three fully loaded with disks and a printer and everything else, it could go out at 10 grand. Mm. In fact, Porsche Isaacson said in 81, I think it had 50% a share of personal computers over $10,000 out the door. And so the people who bought this were not only, well-to-do, had important things to do and righteously angry
right.
about their investment. So we got it turned around, we got some software, created the first basically development support group under, actually if you haven't interviewed him, Bob Martin. Mm-mm. He wound up as Apple's legal guru. He went back to, got a law degree, I think, and wound up in the legal department. Working on things like the Franklin suit, but Bob was the head of the first third-party software development group and licensing group working for me in those days, and hired some Apple stalwarts, people like Russ Aldrich and Brian Stearns. I think Brian may even still be around Apple. Hired him as a 17-year-old kid out of high school. And so we did that. We did some evangelism. Getting things like Great Plains, for example, on the Apple III, and briefly turned it around. But then the XT was really the death knell. The XT and, of course, DOS 2.0 from Microsoft, which borrowed most of the important features of the Apple III OS. So DOS 2.0, for example, had a hierarchical file system, strangely similar to Apple III's OS, and it had device drivers, strangely similar. Might have some, well, I won't start any rumors, but it turns out that the guy who had at Microsoft had the source code to Apple III OS. I don't know if most people know that, but they got that for the to do the CPM board project. So in 82, they had the source to Apple III OS. But in any case, DOS 2.0 and the XT with a hard drive in it were pretty much the death knell for the 3. Mm. There was a 3 plus, which I had kind of gotten started before I left, but engineering really wasn't funded to do anything interesting with it. But it still went on and sold for a couple of years.
I wanted to ask you what you, while you were doing these efforts, and there's the Lisa Macintosh sort of phenomenon mm-hmm. happening, what you made of that that origin of the Lisa and then the Macintosh projects, what was happening at Park, the graphical user interface, object-oriented programming, just that whole the whole development around the Alto,
sure.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and what you thought of that personally.
Yeah, so I looked at the Lisa was, the hardware's pretty well set by, 81. In fact, I don't think the hardware design changed from 81 till its launch in 83, which is unfortunate because they should have upgraded the processor and some other stuff. It was way too slow. The Apple, the Lisa group, the OS there, those were smart guys. They were real computer scientists. And the original Lisa OS, which was intended to be multitasking and some other stuff, their ambition got shot down, and it also got kind of lobotomized from a memory management standpoint. But the people who did it were smart, and I had a lot of respect for them. The applications they wrote were, I mean, it was difficult because they were trying to sort of launch it on the QT, which meant they had to do internal applications. They couldn't turn it loose and let
right.
you know, people develop on it. And it really had a very primitive development environment anyway. Sort of bootstrapped yourself with it. But I was very impressed. And but I could see, because I was also a hardware guy, that I could see that they were hamstringing themselves. Because the hardware was already obsolete years before they actually shipped it. Mm. Well, I mean, look, the Mac came out with an 8 megahertz processor, and the Lisa was still, you know, at 5, I think it was. Plus, they didn't really think about hard drives. They should have built one in from the beginning, and they did those. And of course, the whole Twiggy thing was. Remember I told you Rod Holt was a genius? So Rod Holt was also the guy who told them that the Twiggy, which was their, that was the 800 KB floppy that had opposing holes in the disks, right? You had two heads, right? What Rod explained to him is they were going to have to use laser interferometry to align this thing. And sure enough, it turned out to be darn near that hard a problem. They were not paying attention to the technology. They had a chance to get, in fact, if Apple had decided to invest, well, actually, we'll come back to that story. Apple had a chance to invest in Seagate and buy drives forever at a very low rate. They had a chance to get the manufacturing rights from Sony on the 3.5-inch floppy, which they passed on because they were convinced. In fact, I remember Steve saying, we're going to blow them out of the water when they see Twiggy. I said, that's Steve, but it's kind of cool. It fits right in your pocket. But anyway, the lot of technology decisions there made by non-technologists that kind of hamstrung the company in that era. But Lisa was impressive. That was your real question. And I could see how Mac was going to borrow some of that. And in fact, we had mocked up some things on the Apple III. Wendell had actually designed a 68,000 board for the Apple III using virtual memory notions. Mm. And I had worked with SCO in 83 to look at a port of Unix for that card for the Apple III. Larry and Doug there were fascinated about that idea. So there were, I mean, and Hertzfeld was supposed to do a port of the Mac ROM stuff to that board for the three. But then got told not to do that, which was probably smart because he was way behind on his regular job. But the key was, so that was a technology that was interesting. And when I left Apple in late 82, for various reasons, including the fact that I really thought there were some more interesting things to do, in founding Forethought, Rob and I, Rob Campbell, who had been the Apple II and Apple III software guy, software marketing manager, and had done the controller and some other software like that. Both of us were convinced that that interface and that technology and that approach to applications was the way the world and the future was going to be. And so what we saw was they were just, the company was taking a great concept and putting it on junk hardware. Well, I mean, the Mac. So, all right, so real men program and assembler, right? That was Hertzfeld's approach. And why would you give them more memory so they could write compilers and stuff when, and there was actually a bit of genius about that with the Mac. And that was, there was so little memory that you had to use the ROM to do anything, right? So that part was good. In a sense, there were a couple of people who clobbered together non-Mac kind of style programs on the hardware, but it was very, very hard to do anything useful. So you were kind of pushed into the ROM, which was probably not a terrible idea. The Lisa didn't sell enough to create a platform, and that actually hurt Forethought when we started out because we were hoping that would be a platform for our software. But in reality, they hamstrung the product. They cut off all the important leads on the SCC chip on the Mac so that it couldn't do HDLC, it couldn't emulate terminal. They had 512 bits across, which made no sense for an 80-column emulator. It played hell doing 80-column terminal emulation on the Mac because you had to do 7-bit characters to get enough to get 80 across. And it was just crazy stuff like that that, from my perspective, didn't make any sense. I mean, why would you deliberately limit yourself in building a hardware platform when you were trying to do this insane software?
But the software approach of the graphical user interface and all that you, when you saw it, made sense.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it made sense because, and interestingly enough, one of the most important illustrations of that was something that was kind of almost, you know, by the way, from a software technology standpoint, and that was called the grayed out menu. So if you think about it, and remember the two rivals for object-oriented or graphical user interfaces in those days were VisiCorp's product, Visión, and the Mac, Lisa interface. And of course, there was Microsoft in there with their red herring of Windows, you know, stub version. But the notion there was, and there was also, remember, the big philosophical battle in those days, object-verb, verb-object, right? So do I select something first and then decide what to do with it, or do I decide what to do and then click on what I want to do that to? Even at Park, there were opposing camps about that. The guy VisiCorp hired was in the verb object group, and the Mac and Lisa were all about object verb or subject verb. So point is that if I selected something, then only the things that I could do to that wound up being available to me from a menu standpoint. Now you got to understand, up to that point, I'm sitting at a line, you know, interface. I can type anything, so the number of mistakes I can make are nearly infinite. And therefore, the set of error messages and prompts and stuff like that is also, right? There's no way to steer somebody through a command line interface. Now, you can argue a command line interface for somebody who knows it really well is one of the most efficient tools ever invented. I mean, I watched Peter Rao edit in some of the Unix editors and just flying fingers, amazing stuff. But for the average user, once I select a piece of a paragraph, and I notice that all I can do is change the font, change the size, change this, as opposed to save, delete, right? Yeah. So, and I thought that was genius. Because it just simplified the way you could attack software and a user interface. The rest of the stuff was really nice too. And the notion of working with what you see is what you get. I mean, we'd struggle with that on the Apple II and the Apple III. All kinds of tricks to try and figure out how what you typed sort of formatted itself on the screen. It was a mess. And I had done, in my basic programming series on the Apple III, I'd shown people how to do proportional fonts on the III and so forth and do a proportional font editor. But it was a struggle. So that was the right thing. And when we started Forethought, it was deliberately to do that software. In fact, I think I mentioned to you the whole notion was we knew that was the way to go. We knew that was how to build better software. But we also knew that the hardware platforms weren't quite available yet. We were hoping for Lisa to be successful. It wasn't. The Mac was too small and too limited to do the kind of software we wanted to do, because our notion was something that's now called compound document object-oriented architecture. So a compound document is basically I have a bunch of document-style objects. I got a table, I've got a bitmap, I've got some text. Those are all different flavors of objects that assemble to form a document. The only way you could do that on the Mac, and for that matter on the Lisa, was dead cut and paste. So I could put a graphic into a Word doc, let's say, but I couldn't edit it once it got there.
Right.
Nor was there the kind of publish subscribe kind of link that said if I changed the original, it would change there either.
Right.
We thought both those were going to be critical. And so our first business plan talked about object-oriented software, but it talked about live objects. And to do that, we had to invent some interface stuff that at the time wasn't available on the Mac and Lisa and is now available. And that was the notion of I have to be able to poke an object and have it tell me what it'll do. So the same notion of the subject verb, that could only be live objects and active objects in a compound document could only work if you could do subject verb, because you had to say, hey, tell me what I can do to you. So if I poke a table, I get a different answer than if I poke a paragraph or if I poke a bitmap, right? And so the notion of a dashboard menu that pops up that says, here are your options. Yeah, pull downs are fine, but at the end of the day, if you're selecting objects in a document, you want a pop-up. And so we invented the notion of dashboards and a bunch of stuff like that. Unfortunately, the programming environment wasn't up to the task of building those kinds of things. The geniuses we had from Park, Peter Bishop and Peter Rowell and guys like that, were writing object-oriented code in standard C. There was no C++. Remember, I mean, the tools to build object-oriented environments in those days really didn't exist. And the stuff that the Lisa and Mac groups built was not object-oriented in the classic sense. So, for example, it was a long time before there was a 2-byte editor for text on the Mac to do kanji, for example. So it was what Wigington wrote was pretty straightforward word processor, just really nice looking in the output. So it was a formative time relative to the, you know, what comes first, the application or the tools, right? Heck, in those days, it was hard to find compilers that could, you know, address the amount of memory that you had. One of the things that the Lisa group did, what Couch did in the Lisa group, is contract with a bunch of compiler writers who could build the kind of tools it took to do that kind of code.
Well, before we perhaps dig into really, the leaving Apple and founding Forethought and where these ideas how these ideas for foundation really gelled and came together.
You know that term. You must have talked to somebody else. Yeah.
It must have.
Yeah,
been,
foundation was the, that was the name of that platform.
Right. I can't remember who picked it up somewhere. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about, if I could, just about the Apple culture in those. You know, up until the time you left in late 82, mm-hmm. And stories that you may have about working with both of the founders, what that those experiences were like, just about kind of Apple lore from those eventful 3 years that you were there.
Well, remember, Apple culture formed out of three cultures. So there was the Intel culture that was confrontational, and you were expected to be strong to survive, right? So people got there was the HP culture, which was like nurturing and stuff like that, but appreciative people in their roles, sensitive to careers, things like that. Mm-hmm. But also not particularly aggressive. So HP's idea, for example, of and this some of this culture came to Apple and got killed quickly, but when I was at the old GSD division, HP's notion of engineering to develop a new product was that you searched all the best grad schools and found several students who were doing their PhD thesis in that particular technology. You hired them, gave them a couple of years to kind of acclimate themselves and, you know, get understanding what's going on, and then you ask them to produce the product. Now, what you got was the perfect product, completely, exactly great product, 3 years late. other companies' approach was, Tandem is a good example, it was like hire a guy who's done it three times before, have him sit down, get it done, out the door, right? And so, on the other hand, it wasn't necessarily a great product and wasn't very well thought out. So at the end of the day, HP would tie in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. So so the HP culture came to Apple via people like Tom Whitney and Couch and so forth. The national culture came to Apple via people like Scotty, Mike Scott, right? Not only confrontational, but, you know, very, very aggressive and so forth. Intel was more of a cool version of that, right? Mm. Intellectual and so forth, but also chip-oriented. So neither the national or the Intel people understood systems very well, but the HP people really understood systems and architectures. So you talk to an HP person and they first start with a design and then they work the product within that kind of concept. And some of that came from the lab stuff, right? HP invented a lot of the technology they ultimately used in the products. In fact, we used to go on little tours of HP labs in Palo Alto, and you'd poke through and see, oh, is there anything interesting this month to that we could turn into a product, because they weren't worried about products. those cultures hit at Apple and clashed and created its own kind of blended culture. It became brash and it became get things done and stuff. And then on top of that, the founders, remember, Woz had come out of HP and he was, although I wouldn't call him part of that, he was a tinkerer more than an architect, but he understood innovation and he respected other engineers. Steve, of course, was not a technologist but he understood how to get things done, and he survived quite well in the aggressive part of that culture, because he'd argue with anybody of whatever stripe, and so forth. So for me, the part that was good was the desire to do cool things, right? And that was still there. What came about and kind of froze the culture in place is Think about when you hire, right? You start with a few people, and they hire their friends who they know and trust, and know are cool people and smart people and stuff, and then you go outward. And I like to think of it, in a small company, the culture is that everybody is faced outward. Your competitor is your real competitor in the marketplace, right? Is somebody who's trying to defeat you and your company.
Right.
So you're circling the wagons in a sense, but everybody's faced out. And so you don't worry about your back because nobody else is looking at your back. They're all looking at another issue or another problem, right? But as the company grows, any company grows, and it's certainly true for Apple, that circle expands and it gets filled in with people you hire through standard processes that nobody knows and doesn't even know if they're any good or not. And who do they face? Well, they're not facing the customer anymore. They're facing each other. Mm-hmm. So their competitor is a person in another department or in their same department. And suddenly the internal competition begins to eat away. And the only, at the end, the real Apple culture that I saw in 83, 85 that I really liked was the field. Because they were the last people in the company who were actually facing customers all the time and competitors. And so the Apple field, that's why typically sales forces have a different culture than the company anyway. But in Apple, the keeper of the flame of the old Apple, for me, ultimately in the mid-80s, was the sales force.
Interesting.
Because they still, one of them, there were a lot of still people around, but they also were like genuinely just interested in beating competitors right. as opposed to each other.
Right.
And
what about working with Steve Jobs? There's a whole genre of storytelling about that.
Oh, yes.
And I wondered if
those
were most meaningful for you.
Well, I mean, it was a force of nature. I mean, I like to think almost of that he hired me because when I first went to Apple, as I said, I came from HP, but I had known other people who went to Apple. So as young as I was smart enough to know that I was supposed to get some stock. And so when they made the first offer, I kind of assumed that was too low, and so I asked for more. And that's what led for me to be interviewed by Steve because he was the one that had to kind of sign off on any more than the standard offer. So I did my first of many Steve conversations, which was the classic, let's walk around the building. He hated to talk to people in his office in a standard setting. His thing was, let's get out. And so we made, five or six laps around Manly One, and we chatted about a bunch of stuff and I guess he thought I was an okay guy. Steve and I stayed in touch, and when I went to work for him, he came to appreciate the kind of organization stuff or let's solve problems. I remember I used VisiCalc from the moment it was out, and I created a table in VisiCalc of text, status report. So at that point, most of the status reports he got were, I worked real hard last week and I took 40 phone calls and stuff and stuff. And so what I created was a report on the Apple II that in one column had all of the big issues. And then it was like who was working on it and what was the resolution or something like that. And so I basically used VisiCalc as a word processor. But you couldn't do columns and certainly couldn't do tables in the Apple II word processor at the time. So when I printed this out for him, he said, that's it, that's what I want. Because he was also a what's the most important thing, let's get it done kind of guy, right? So we got along fine until we conflicted. And what we conflicted over was the fact that I'm writing millions of dollars of checks every month to the Lisa and Mac groups, and I'm getting no resources we were running the Apple II, Apple III division, R&D, 3% of sales. I was in a rivalry with the software group within the Apple II division for who was going to be most profitable. The Apple II went out the door typically between 60 and 70 gross points of margin. Unheard of for hardware. right? And that money was going straight to these development groups. And I said, you can't keep this up. When I tried to do the 2E, I almost got, damn near got fired in that. And finally, Woz and a couple other people intervened and said, no, we really probably need to do that improvement, because Steve wanted to cancel the 2E. And actually, probably the only thing it saved it was the Rohner's chip, right? They did this incredible chip where they put most of the Apple II logic on a single chip, and that was sufficiently interesting enough technically, you know, and fit the mantra of fewer chips, so that Steve finally, I think, went along with it. But he really, I once said Steve was like the His vision of a $500 million company was a company that was built on the ruins of the previous $500 million company. It's like the old, think about it, you know, medieval cathedrals, they're almost always built using the stones from the previous church, right? Because it's a lot easier to do that than it is drag stones from another place. And so my notion was, well, you know, we could probably have a $1 billion company if we took the old $500 million company and then built a new one next door, right? And so he didn't really see eye to eye. For him, the old was a rival of the new and threatened the survival of the new, right? So I remember one of my tasks as the Apple II product marketing guy and then the Apple III group was making the rounds of engineering to cheer up people that Steve had been visiting. So when he was recruiting people for the Mac group, his notion was, of course, they're the best and the brightest, and everybody else is strum and drang. And he would wander into somebody's cube over in Banley 3 and say, well, you know, at this point he's the chairman, right? And not to mention the icon that Scully was trying to make him into and later on. And so he would come in and say, well, what are you doing? And the engineer would go, oh, well, I'm working on this bug. You know, we have this really tricky problem that, you know, if this happens, stuff like that, and I think I've just about solved it. And Steve would go, what? You're working on a bug? You're fixing this old crap when you could be, you know, doing great things, blah, 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 and stuff like that? You're just worthless, aren't you? And of course, and then he would leave. And of course, the guy sits in his cube vibrating and like, you know, so much jello. And I'd have to come by and explain to him that, yes, fixing bugs and helping customers was really an important thing that the company needed to do. But on the other hand, that ability to not care about the impression left on other people was incredibly powerful. I mean, it was like a drug. But on the other hand, it got him into incredible problems. I'll never forget, I got a call from Jean Richardson, who was Apple's director of marketing at the time. And she said, you got to get over here right away. We've got these visitors in and you have to talk to them. So I came over and I said, what's going on? Well, it turned out there was a delegation from Japan. And I don't know if this story has ever been told that many times, but they were writing a series of books for Japanese school children. Kind of a Horatio Alger series.
Okay.
And they decided that the one American they were going to feature in the series was Steve Jobs, Mr. Innovation, right? So they had done all the research for the book and had it all set, but the only thing left remaining, now some of this may be a bit apocryphal, so I'm doing this from memory, but this would be like 82. So they send a delegation over, put them in a conference room, and Steve is supposed to come in and talk to them. They've got their tape recorders out and running and stuff like that, so all they need to do is get this final interview and they'll put the wrapper on the book. Well, Steve waltzed in, according to Gene, about 10 or 15 minutes late and proceeded to chew them out. What are you thinking? Japanese innovation? Another fish flopping up on our shore? You can't possibly know anything about innovation, yada, yada, for about 5 or 10 minutes, straight out, turns around, walks out of the room. Tape recorder still going. You know, and they're all looking around, I'm sure, for swords, right, to do the... and so Gene basically said, that's what happened. You need to go, like, tell them the history of Apple or do something. You know, just get them out of here, right? Exactly. So I went in and did, you know, 10 minutes or 15 minutes. I have no idea what I said, but it was just designed to make them stop quivering. And then they left, and the book never never was published. But that was, it was, but that was powerful. It's like, how could you do that? And the answer is, I don't know, but there's a certain fascination about it. I was quoted by the Mercury News when Steve was exited in 85 as saying that working for Steve was like riding backwards on a roller coaster. You weren't sure where you were going, but you were definitely getting there in a hurry. And that was the feeling. If he believed in you, you could crash through walls, right? If he didn't believe in you, you know, you didn't have a life left. There's a lot of cult thing about that. I mean, you go back to the Joneses of the world and so forth, and it's that singular belief in a powerful leader that has no fear and no doubt. If he did have doubts about anything, I never saw him express them.
Interesting.
And again, that's powerful because most people are plagued by doubt. Oh, am I doing the right thing? Oh, is this the right thing to do? Oh my God, what's going to happen? Nah. Nope, that's wrong, that's right. Now, the thing is that that was part of his power too. I said he was not a technologist, but if you put him in a room with 20 products and he'll spot the two hot products every time. He had an uncanny ability to say, that's trash, that's not. But if you put him in a room with a whiteboard and give him a, you know, a marker and say, come up with something hot, not a clue.
But kind a great, of an exquisite taste.
Exquisite taste and a great editor. Right.
And was Steve Wozniak working, was he that 3% that you were able to spend on
R&D? You put Woz in a room with a bunch of parts, and he would invent something, right? So in that sense, so Woz was, he was interested in stuff. You know, when he left Apple the second or third time, or maybe after the whole Rocky episode at Berkeley, you know, he started Cloud 9, and one of its first products was a universal controller for, you know, TVs and appliances and stuff like that. And he cooked up this idea that, hey, a microprocessor could be general purpose programmed to control all the. Well, where the heck did that idea come from? You know, it was just one of a gazillion kind of things. And he was completely genuine. He's the only person I knew at Apple who never changed from the first day I met him to practically now. I mean, it was that same open personality, and, you know, I remember when I was first at Apple, I was on a bowling team with him. Apple had a couple of teams in a league and stuff like that, and he was just a very genuine person. And he was also kind and sensitive. I remember Woz set up a, just before the company went public, one of the things that they noticed was they hadn't exactly been, because of this whole HR mangle at the beginning, they hadn't exactly been equitable about the passing out of options. And in fact, they had what a lot of us called the guilt round just before the company went public, where they gave a bunch of people stock that they just kind of, you know, accidentally screwed over, because each manager sort of decided on their own. So some people were very generous. Right. People who worked for Couch did extremely well. People who worked for others did very poorly. And so they had the guilt round, but Woz set up a table outside Bandley 3 and sold people founder stock at $7 a share, I think it was. And this was literally months before the company went public. The company went public at 22. So people lined up and just bought shares. It was founder stock. It had to be cleaned, so it wasn't exactly liquid, you know, from the get-go. But he just felt that he realized people had gotten screwed, and he just decided to do something about it.
He did his own employee stock plan.
He did his own employee stock plan. And the smart employees lined up at that table. But yeah, that was Woz.